You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
For the community, by the community.
For the community, by the community.
For the community, by the community.
Welcome back to episode 3 of Two Guys and a Lot of Wine. I'm your host, Bobby P.
And I'm James Kimbrough.
And after a short hiatus due to the festive wine-filled holidays, we're back for our Valentine's show, which will be featuring wines that pair well with chocolate.
What now, could be more romantic?
There is
wine
nothing.
And chocolate.
As Dean Martin says, that's amore when it comes to pairing wine and chocolate. Of course, I just made that up, but I know he did say that's amore. Some people say that it can't be done easily when it comes to pairing wine with chocolate.
It's very difficult. Chocolate is very intense. It's got a lot of fruity flavors, some sweetness, some bitterness, and some acidity. And then wines are very complex as well. So, you know, the two are going to clash. But it's if you taste enough, which we're going to do tonight,
yes,
you can find some great pairings.
And the fun is, if it is a good pairing, it could be a match made in heaven. So both you and your special lady will be in heaven yourself. And we're going to be tasting four tonight. We're going to be tasting a really good French Merlot from 2005. We have a California Cab, highly rated. And Jim, you have a...
We've brought a California Petite Syrah.
And hopefully we're going to close the show with an absolutely fantastic Zinfandel, which I'm really looking forward to. We got into that bottle a little earlier, and we're dying to actually taste it with chocolate. We haven't yet, and we're really looking forward to that. Now, when it comes to pairing wine with chocolate, it's usually best to match a wine with the types of chocolate. Like, for instance, a heavy chocolate, like a dark chocolate, probably is going to pair better with a Cab or Merlot.
The darker chocolates go with the darker wines. So if you've got a milk chocolate, for example, you'd want to use a lighter wine like a Merlot. We're going to have a Petite Syrah tonight. And then if you have a white chocolate, you want to go even sweeter. You can start off with a Muscat, the bubbling Prosecco, or the Asti Spumante from Italy. You can even do a Ruby Port. But tonight we're going to go in the complete opposite direction and do a contrast. So we're going to have a very heavy Zin, a big, bold Zin, to go with the white chocolate.
Which, from what I understand, and I haven't done it yet, it's supposed to almost melt in your mouth like butter when it's paired
absolutely,
with a strong
Zin.
So I'm really excited about that. And in regards to the types of chocolate, if you're going to be doing this with you and your special lady for Valentine's Day, you want to use a good quality chocolate. I wouldn't go and just buy a 99-cent chocolate bar.
No.
Ghirardelli's, Lindt, something that's, that is good stuff.
Something complex.
Absolutely.
You want a lot of different flavors in the chocolate, just like you have a lot of different flavors coming out in the wines. And hopefully, if you pair this correctly, the two are going to unfold in your mouth at the same time. It's going to be a phenomenal experience. So.
And what's great about doing this for Valentine's Day is, sure, you can buy a little gift or a stuffed animal, but this is a much more intimate and a much more classier way to celebrate Valentine's Day than just the standard box of chocolates, stuffed animal, ho-hum. Anybody could do that.
Right.
You will score some major brownie points doing it the Jim and Bob way.
Yes, this shows you put some thought into this. Maybe you do a little secret tasting of your own before you present this to your partner.
Absolutely. And before we even taste the first one, which is the French Merlot, just a little bit about the vineyard. It's the flagship varietal brand, and it's produced only from the best varietal grapes in France. It's actually from one of the largest vineyards in France. And it's fermented in lined temperature-controlled cement vats, and aged in both American and French oak. And we're going to taste the aging process in our palate right now.
All right.
Jim? Now we're going to be tasting a 60% cocoa dark chocolate with this. And this actually is my first tasting of this type of chocolate with a wine. So you want to take a sip of the wine first, just to coat your tongue.
Very smooth, mellow, you know, typical of a Merlot. And then you get a lot of fruit in the chocolate, which is not always the case, but in this situation.
I actually think that the wine definitely opens up both the intensity of the chocolate and...
It does. You get the sweetness of the chocolate in the middle, and at the end, yeah, it just kind of fades away. It's very nice.
It does. It's a really nice pairing. And I'm not, like I said, I've never been a big fan of the dark chocolate, but tasting it with the wine, it's sort of a very interesting and pleasant experience. Yeah. And when it comes to Merlots, there's a host of different varietals of Merlots. I chose things that I haven't tasted yet tonight. I don't think Jim has had any of these yet either.
No, I haven't.
And I think this one, it's a 2005, which was a relatively pretty good year for this vineyard. And I do think that the flavor, compared to what the price point is pretty good.
What ballpark are we talking for the price point?
Oh, yes. For this one, it's under $15, which...
Very affordable?
A very affordable price for a good French quality Merlot. And once again, for this show today, it's pairing with a chocolate, which makes it even more elegant.
And I have to admit, I love that pairing. Those worked out very well together.
Those were really good. And when it comes to certain types of chocolate other than a dark chocolate, there's different types of cocoa mix. This is a 60% cocoa mix. There are 50% cocoa mix. There's 55% cocoa mix. When it comes to pairing this type of chocolate, from what my research seems to suggest, is you shouldn't go any higher than 70-75% cocoa when it comes to the...
Yeah, I've had chocolates that were up to 90% cocoa, and they tend to get very bitter. And at that point, the only option you're going to have to pair that with is going to be a cab with a lot of tannin. And we're going to move on to a Zin now.
Actually, we're going to move on to the cab.
Oh, we're going to move on to the cab.
We'll go to another dark chocolate. With just a hint of salt in it. It's a Lindbar, but there are different varietals out there. And cabs are, you know, I tend to be prone to enjoying cabs more so than Merlot sometimes. That Merlot is still floating around on my tongue. So we're going to taste the Tin Roof cab from California. It's from the acclaimed North Coast and Central Coast wine growing region. Once again, it's a highly regarded vineyard. And we're looking at the same price point as we just did with the St. Martin. There you go, Jim.
I can taste a lot more tannins in that wine.
And generally, that is the case with a cab, right? It's
yes.
Definitely going to be a little bit more
yep.
in-your-face type flavor.
Typically. And you're getting a lot of the oak in this one also.
And this particular varietal is blended with a small amount of Merlot and Petite Sirah, so it should be a little bit more smoothly textured and complex. And all the wines you're seeing tonight are available locally.
I like this chocolate. It has, as you mentioned, some salt in it, and you taste the salt at the end. So it starts off very sweet, and then as it's changing in your mouth, you get the salty finish.
Yeah, it's a whole different experience than the first one we just had.
Yeah, and the chocolate kind of mellows down the tannin taste in the cab also, so it's not as harsh. I've had some cabs that are very tannic. If we had one of those tonight, this would mellow it down completely, change the taste of the wine and turn it into almost a different wine for you.
And I know some people, you know, when it comes to Merlot or a cab, there are, of course, distinct differences in the wine. And even though I'm more prone myself to like a good California cab, there are still some excellent California Merlots. And I think the first one we tasted is still hitting my back palate a little bit. And I think I'm...
You need to cleanse the palate, huh?
Need to cleanse the palate a little bit. So I'm going to take another sip of this cab. Yeah, that's very good.
You taste the different stages. It's you get some fruitiness, and then you get the sweetness, and then you get the tannin at the end with this. So there's three different flavors going on in your mouth with this.
And the Tin Roof was highly recommended by wine enthusiasts, and I think they scored it 86 points. And they label it as bone dry, but I wouldn't necessarily agree with that.
I wouldn't call it bone dry.
It's dry.
It's dry.
Bone dry, I think, is a little bit extreme. And also, when it comes to the wines we're tasting tonight with chocolate, and I think Jim alluded to it earlier, this is also good to do with sparkling and champagne. Now, obviously, we couldn't taste everything tonight. But what we're doing also sometimes compare very well with sparkling, as we talked about in our last show.
You've got to be very careful with the sparklings, though. Most sparklings are not going to taste as well with chocolate as they would on their own. What you want to look for is a very sweet sparkling, like an Asti Spumante or a Muscat d'Asti. Those are typically in the Italian section. They've got a lot of fizz to them, but they also have a very sugary taste. And that's going to go well with the white chocolate, especially, that we're going to try later.
Actually, that's a good point. When it comes to tasting chocolate, I actually don't think you want to have a dry type of wine. I would think it diffuses the experience with the chocolate. If, like, say you were doing champagne, and it was a dry champagne, like a Brut.
Yeah, the rule of thumb really is to have a sweeter wine than the chocolate is. If you have a fairly sweet chocolate, you want the wine to be even a little bit sweeter. That's not always possible, and we'll probably hit one of these pairings tonight where it doesn't work out that way. In fact, it's going to happen with the white and Zin pairing.
Well, so far I've been very pleased with so far both things that we tasted.
We've done pretty well.
And we're
going to
make another round again just to see that we both agree before the end of the show. So I think we're up to the Petite Syrah now.
Petite Syrah. This is also from California. And I just tasted this for the first time 2 weeks ago.
That's a really dark.
Really nice and dark. compare the colors here, you know, the first one we had started out almost kind of a reddish, brown color, and then you're going to a deep purple with this one.
Oh, my glass.
I was ready to drink without.
I know you were, Jim. That's quite all right. I'll join you in 1 second. Okay. There you go.
All right. We're going to pair this with a milk chocolate. It's a lighter chocolate.
Wow, those are some heavy legs on this one.
Now, when you taste this, it's a very smooth wine, almost no tannins, a little bit of blueberry flavor in it, and a little cola.
I'm definitely tasting things that I did not taste in the first two, and I'm still fascinated by the legs on this. Look at that. That's still dripping down the sides of the glass.
This blew me away when I had it 2 weeks ago. It's a very complex wine. People around me were just astounded at how it was changing in their mouth as they were tasting it. The start and the finish are very different for this wine. So let's try it with the chocolate.
And once again, this was a milk chocolate. Extra creamy milk chocolate, but you can use your own varietal. Now, that's fascinating. It definitely changes the complexity and the taste of the wine.
Absolutely.
At first, it was very strong, but in a positive way. And the milk chocolate really did seem to mellow it out a lot.
Mellowed it out, and that brings out a lot of the fruit. I got much more of the fruit taste the second time with the chocolate than I did on the initial tasting.
I think this is worth a second piece of
chocolate. Absolutely.
For this one.
Do it again.
And what price point is this one, Jim?
This is a more expensive wine, especially for the types of wines we tend to drink on this show. This is going to be the $25 to $30 range. We like to keep our wines down, $10, $15, sometimes up to $20. So this is a bit of a splurge for the show.
It's Valentine's Day.
That's right.
Fellas, you got to splurge on your lady. Don't cheap out. Not that these are cheap, but, occasionally you do got to spend that extra dollar.
One comment I heard someone else make when they were trying this wine was, how do they squeeze so many different flavors out of one grape? And you notice how many different times it changes in your mouth.
It's absolutely fascinating. It's a delicious wine, and I could see why you were drawn to it.
A lot of times when you buy a more expensive wine, you get a couple of extra flavor changes in your mouth, and that's certainly the case here.
So. Well, since we've had an opportunity to taste three, I'm going to go back to the dark cocoa one again, and I'm going to try the dark cocoa with this cap to see if there was a difference in with the flavor of the wine, if it changed differently compared to the milk chocolate we just had. Now, once again, the dark chocolate is a drier chocolate.
It's much more bitter now. We're tasting a very bitter taste. Again, this is the Petite Sirah.
Now, see, this is why we love doing this show, because I actually don't like this pairing at all.
I don't care for it either.
It doesn't work at all with a dark chocolate.
Mm-mm. It's got a bad finish. It's a very bitter finish also.
Yep, completely, I wouldn't say unpalatable, but not my favorite at all. Fascinating.
That was not this pairing would not make you look good on Valentine's Day.
It would not. Don't try that at home. Why don't we try it with a touch of salt, which is a more softer, darker chocolate. I don't need to keep staying on this one particular
wine. There's just so much in it, though.
Just so much in it going on. Not as dark of a chocolate. Not as bad as the overly dark chocolate.
I still get the salty finish.
Yep.
But it's kind of bland.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah. Yeah, this paired best with the milk chocolate.
The milk chocolate, the extra creamy milk chocolate, really opened up the flavor of the wine. It was a marriage made in heaven, just like I said earlier. If you pair the right chocolate with the right wine, your mouth is happy, you're happy, everybody in the house is happy. Now, I just realized we're one glass short, so we might have to finish this
one here.
Petite Sirah. Now, that leads us up into the Zinfandel, which I'm a huge fan of Zin. And this particular one, though we were going to originally save it for the show, I couldn't resist tasting it and opened it up earlier. So it has been sitting for many hours, which is just
It got a chance to breathe.
A chance to breathe, both in the bottle and in my lungs. And we're going to be pairing that with white chocolate. And a good Zin, from what I understand, from what my research has suggested, is supposed to really be a match made in heaven.
This is the contrast that I was talking about earlier. With white chocolate, you typically want a very sweet wine, but you can go the complete opposite direction and do a contrast, and that's what we're going to do with the Zin.
Now, generally, you would, of course, want to use a clean glass, but because of my forgetfulness, I did not bring a fourth glass. There you go. Now, I know you can't actually taste this at home, but a good Zinfandel, or Zinfandel, is really completely different than any of the three wines that are on the table tonight. I can't how to best describe a Zinfandel. I don't know if you have the vocabulary to explain the flavors that are going on.
Well, again, there's some fruit here, and I'm trying to identify what it is. It's not strawberry or raspberry. But it has a lot of fruit up front, and then kind of just fades away. So we'll see how the chocolate helps.
I definitely get a more buttery, smoother flavor. I'm not sure that I like the pairing as much as I did with the creamy milk chocolate with your Petite Sirah, but it's still good.
Yeah.
It's still enjoyable.
Yeah, not my favorite for tonight, but this is certainly a good pairing.
And I think another example, actually, I think what we should try to do tonight is taste the creamy milk chocolate with this to see what that is like. Do you need any more? Do you still have a little?
I still have some. Yeah, with the white chocolate, you get a little bit of honey and vanilla, and that comes out most especially in the finish and the lingering aftertaste. So it'll be interesting to see how the milk chocolate changes this.
Still not as good. Yep, still not as good. Good, but not nearly as good as the Petite Sirah paired with the creamy milk chocolate.
I have to say that was my favorite for the night, too.
So an early preliminary judgment of what we've drank so far tonight, and we're going to taste everything again really quickly one more time, is definitely thumbs up on the Petite Sirah.
Absolutely, yeah. That was the big winner for tonight.
And once again, available locally. I think wine sellers might have it, or super sellers.
Super sellers had this one.
Same thing with anything on the table tonight. Any of the larger wine stores in the area, we'll have them on our Facebook page, and you can definitely go in and find them. For the Zinfandel, though I enjoyed it earlier without the taste of chocolate, I'm going to say with pairing with at least the chocolates that we've had tonight, it was good, but not fantastic. I mean, I wouldn't not serve it or not pair it.
I would drink it on its own.
Without a pairing of the chocolate.
Yeah. You know, I'll try this with the dark chocolate just to,
yeah, actually,
just to
that's
give it the benefit
idea.
Of the doubt here. Yeah, the chocolate kind of coagulates.
Sure did.
In your mouth.
Yes, it did.
And yeah, I didn't care for that at all. So, I'm not going to say thumbs down on the Zinfandel, but I would say if you're going to drink it by its own, by
yeah,
itself.
I would just go with eh. Eh. That's where I would go. You had a few comments you wanted to make on something too, Jim.
Absolutely. I get asked all the time, you taste so many wines, how do you keep track of all of them? And what I like to do is when I finish drinking the bottle, peel the label off and make some notes, and then just stick them all in a notebook. Now, when you finish the bottle, you can just put it in some hot water, soak it for a few minutes, take it off with a razor blade, stick it right here in the notebook, make a few notes. The next time you drink it, come back, make some more notes. And when you go to the wine store, it's very easy to remember what you've had and just to tell the wine merchant, hey, this is the label I want right here. And then go pick it right off the shelf for you.
And trust me, do this routine because so many times we've tasted stuff and either we've thrown out the bottle
yep.
or we just completely forgot about it. We can't
yep.
remember what we tasted. And
yeah, we forget to take notes and then we have to drink it all over again on our next get-together.
Now, how long have you been working on that particular?
I've been doing this for over 10 years. I have filled over 4 notebooks. I'm on my 5th notebook right now. And some of the wines I go back and I can't even get them here in Connecticut anymore. So that just shows you how the wine industry changes. New wines come in, old wines have to get moved out, and they're no longer sold here in the state. So it's a great way to keep up on what you like. And it's especially for, you know, if you're hosting a party, like for New Year's, for example, I pulled out one of the books, thumbed through, picked out 3 or 4 wines. I had the whole evening planned.
And he did. It was a fantastic evening with our ladies. And Jim, you did a fantastic job with both the food and the wine,
well,
which
you.
Was extremely enjoyable. You know, I'm going to go back to, I think, the St. Martin really quick because I did not pair this with a white chocolate.
Okay.
And I'm going to give that a shot.
That was the first one we had.
Mm-hmm. I got to say, once again, I still think that your Petit Sirah is the wine of the night. I mean, I'm absolutely shocked at how good that's paired with pretty much almost everything we've tasted tonight. And when you tasted that, that was just the other night, correct?
It was 2 weeks ago.
Oh, 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
And was that at a wine tasting?
It was a wine tasting I go to regularly. So I knew the distributor very well. I trusted her opinion. And then as soon as I tasted it, I knew this had to be on the show tonight. So,
and that's another good point. I mean, Valentine's Day is a few weeks away or a month away.
Depending on when you're watching this show,
actually,
it might
please,
have already happened.
Don't forget Valentine's Day or you'll really be in big trouble. But you have time to maybe do a little experimenting on your own. You know, guys, you know, go out there, look at the wine. You see what we've tasted tonight. You know what we're giving so far a thumbs up for with the Petit Sirah. Go find some good quality chocolates. You know, do some tastings on your own before you even surprise your lady. And, of course, ladies, you can surprise your husband, too, or your boyfriend. Don't take that the wrong way. And, you know, experiment yourself so you can at least give the person that you're going to be doing the tasting with some guidelines as to what, you know, you're tasting and what they think they should taste. And I think what's great about this is it's a type of activity that both of you can be engaged in rather than just here's your gift,
Absolutely.
Here's your card.
Yeah.
You know.
And there's no right or wrong answers with this, so you feel free to put your opinion out there. You're entitled to state exactly what's going on in your mouth, and it's going to be completely different from what's going on in your partner's mouth.
And what's good about this is episode 3 of Two Guys and a Lot of Wine, and there's going to be a lot more to come. And that's really what we really want to hammer home. There is no right or wrong answer. It's what we taste yep. here. If you go out and purchase and try, you may say, what the heck were those two guys talking about? This tastes like doggy poop.
Yeah.
So,
and that's my first rule of thumb is drink what you like. And because you're going to like something completely different than what I like and what Bob likes.
And there are no wrong answers. The whole fun of wine tasting in general is to experience all the different types of varietals and make up your own mind as to what you like best. And the cab, which was this one right here, which I think was my second favorite of the night.
Yeah, that's where I'd put it.
I did not taste this one. Oh, I did taste that one. I did not taste this one with the dark chocolate, so I want to give that a quick taste just to, before I give my final approval on everything tonight.
I think I've got that one right here.
Oh, now see, that's a surprise. That one did not pair too badly at all, which isn't surprising because it paired well with the darker chocolate with a touch of salt.
Yep.
So it should pair well with the 60% cocoa.
And it does. Yeah, the fruit really jumps out with this pairing. I like this.
Your legs on your Petit Sirah, though, have still been the best tonight. And I know that's not always a big deal, but in a way it is because your Petit Sirah, because the legs were so heavy, it also had a very intense and a full-bodied flavor.
Well, that's usually what the legs tell you, is how much body is in the wine. And so when you see the legs just clinging to the glass like they are, it's an indicator that you're going to have a lot of body with the wine.
And that's generally the rule whenever you see a...
That's what you're looking for, how much body is in the wine, and you're judging that on how long the legs are hanging on the glass.
Now, though we didn't have a chance to taste many whites, or actually any whites tonight, are there any in your research, is there anything you saw that would pair well with chocolate that we didn't get a chance to taste?
The Asti Spumante that I mentioned earlier, Muscat. Now, there's also something called an orange Muscat, which has orange flavor infused into the wine. You could go with the classic Gewürztraminer. Or a Riesling. Any of the sweeter wines are going to pair really well with the white chocolate. And again, you're going to get a lot of honey, a lot of vanilla flavor with the white chocolate.
And in general, that's pretty much your...
That's what I...
Your range for white.
Yeah. With milk chocolate, you could also pair that with ruby port. Now, we didn't talk about port tonight.
That's true.
And that's going to be a whole other show at some point far, far off in the future. Bob and I don't drink a whole lot of port to begin with, so we're going to have to do a lot of research for that one.
We are going to have to do a lot of research. Port is... it can be good, but it's kind of one of those advanced wines where, it's not something that you're going to be able to pour a lot of and drink fast.
And it's an acquired taste also.
It is an acquired taste, and I haven't had a lot of experience with port. I hope to have more experience with port, maybe as we do this show. And Jim's going to have a fantastic guest in our next show next month, and we're looking forward to that. We're just not going to tell you who that is, but please watch next month because it's going to be a very exciting show.
We're teasing it now.
We will tease you a little bit now. But I do want to say that we're glad that we have a lot of supporters so far in our third show, and we're looking forward to continue to do more shows. And
don't forget to check out our website.
Absolutely.
We're on Facebook now, Two Guys and a Lot of Wine. Look for us on Facebook. Feel free to friend us or like us.
And comment. Please comment because we want feedback. If there's something that you see that maybe we're not featuring and maybe you want us to taste, we're only two guys and we can't taste everything, but if we get some feedback...
We're happy to try new wines.
We are very happy to try new wines. And that's really what this show is all about, to give both us and you the opportunity to experience wines with us, have a good time, have some chocolate, and just enjoy life in general, as we do. So I still have a little bit of wine left here in this glass, and this was the...
Well, real quickly, let's do our recommendations here.
Actually, you're right. The recommendations are, obviously, the Petit Sirah.
Love thumbs the Petit Sirah. Yeah, big thumbs up on that one.
The Zinfandel.
Yeah.
Yeah, just The cab, thumbs up.
I like that, yeah. I'm giving that a thumbs up.
The French Merlot.
I'm going to try that one more time. I'm going to give that one a thumbs down.
Thumbs down on that one. I'm going to give that one a thumbs up, just to be different, just to be a little conflicting.
The chocolate is what's throwing this. It was very good pairing with the chocolate. If you're looking for a Merlot for Valentine's Day, I would recommend this with the dark chocolate.
Well, we had a great third show. Happy Valentine's Day to everyone and all our fans, my beautiful wife.
And my beautiful girlfriend.
And until next time, I'm Bobby P.
And I'm James Kimbrough.
And until next time,
keep us in your wine cellar.